We find everywhere, actually, that the best option is always to divide into triangles, because any 3D surface in the universe is able to be approximated by fitting together triangles. In talking about how 3D computer-generated images are created and how they work, there are a number of different questions that we need to address and problems that we need to solve. And the first of those is, how do we take a 3D object and represent it in the computer? And so the way we do this is by using a coordinate system. Every day we have maps and graphs and things that all use this coordinate system. It's called the Cartesian coordinate system. Generally we have two axes, one called X, one called Y, and if we want to specify a point anywhere on the graph, we have two numbers which represent the distances that we travel along each axis. So if we have point 2, 1, we go 1, 2, 1, there's point 2, 1, simple enough. Using this system, we can represent any unique point anywhere on the plane described by these axes. And we can also, you know, go this way and this way to have negative points as well. So that's plus X plus Y minus X minus Y. And this way we can have minus 2 minus 1 here. So that's two dimensions, but if we want to specify points in three dimensions, we simply add another axis. Going through the middle like this, it's perpendicular to X and Y, but obviously it's a 2D piece of paper. So and this is called Z, so we'll call that plus Z and this minus Z. So now we can have point 2, 1, and this is on plane 0 in Z, so that's 2, 1, 0, and this becomes minus 2, minus 1, 0. Using this system, and three number coordinates, we can specify any unique point relative to the origin here and the axes that we've specified. What use is this when we want to describe something like a pyramid? Well, typically what we want to do is use our coordinate system to specify the corners of the objects, which we call vertices. Let's get another piece of paper here. Let's describe the points of our pyramid using our 3D coordinate system. Let's call them A, B, C, D, and then round the back, E. Using our coordinates, A will be at 0, 2, 0, say. B will be at minus 1 in X, 0 in Y, minus 1 in Z. C will be at plus 1 in X, 0 in Y, minus 1 in Z, and so on for the other two. Using these coordinates, we can specify the corners or the vertices of our object, but that's not quite enough, because all we're doing is specifying the corners, and our representation says nothing at all about the faces of the pyramid. So how do we go about representing the faces? Well, one way of doing it, a simple way, would be to specify a new set of vertices, three coordinates for every face. So we'll have one here, 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 etc. The problem is, this incurs a lot of duplication of vertices. So, for example, this vertex at the top, point A on the diagram, is required by all four of these faces. So if we're specifying three coordinates for every face, we're duplicating the top one four times. For a simple object like a pyramid, that's not too much of a problem. But if we have a model with 100,000 vertices in, then the wastage can be quite considerable. So there is a better system for specifying the faces of any geometry. And to do that, we use a separate data structure to represent the faces, which references the vertices that we've described using our Cartesian coordinates. So if we name them, as we have done on the diagram, A, B, C, we can then say that this face is represented by vertices A, B, C, and this face is A, C, D, and then this face is A, D, E, and then this faces AEB. And then we have a problem, because when we come to represent the base of the pyramid, it's a square. And that doesn't really fit into our system of three vertices per face. So what we could do is find some way of specifying that these faces all have three vertices each, and this one has four. And for another shape, it might have five vertices or something like that. But in practice, it's better just to split the base into two triangles. We find everywhere, actually, that the best option is always to divide into triangles, because any 3D surface in the universe is able to be approximated by fitting together triangles. And why are triangles so good for this purpose? Well, first of all, it's the simplest polygon. There's only three vertices in a triangle. Second of all, and more importantly, any arrangement of three vertices in 3D space will always be coplanar, which means that no matter how you arrange the three vertices of a triangle, they will always lie on the same plane in space, which is a crucial property if you want to approximate a surface with a simple two-dimensional polygon or a set of them. It doesn't work for other types of polygon, so a rectangle, for example. In this case, it's okay because the vertices are all coplanar, they're nice and flat. But if I were to lift one of them, well, let's go with this one, out of the plane of the other three, we'd no longer have a valid rectangle, because these three are all coplanar, but this isn't. I mean, it's got a curved surface to it, so it's not a proper rectangle anymore. So for that reason, using rectangles or higher order shapes other than triangles are surfaces that we are approximating might be in danger of having degenerate faces that aren't properly represented, because we might have one vertex that's raised out of the plane of the face. But triangles don't suffer from this problem. Sean has asked me now to demonstrate how a cylinder might be represented by triangles. So let's draw some triangles onto it. So let's start with the circle at the top. Generally, it's quite easy to subdivide into triangles. But what we find is that this curved edge here will start to look a little bit jaggy with these straight edges, which I've not drawn on very well. But of course, the more triangles we use, the better the approximation to the circle. So as we add more and more, these straight lines approximate a curve better and better. On the side of the cylinder, we just use almost exactly the same principle. We can create triangles like this. I mean, there are millions of ways to do this. And it's the same situation as on the top, whereby the more triangles we have, the denser the tessellation, the better approximation to the curved surface we'll get. So, as you see, I mean, any surface, pretty much this, a sphere, anything can be represented by triangles, any conceivable surface in the universe, in three dimensions at any rate. So there's a further problem in that when we specify a triangle as A, B, C, we're really specifying two triangles, one on the front and one on the back. In the pyramid, we have the triangles facing out and the triangles facing in. And sometimes we might want to be able to differentiate between which way a triangle is facing. Is it facing out or is it facing in? And the way that is achieved is by being very careful about the order in which the vertex coordinates is specified.
So it's called winding when you basically decide.
Yes, because you're winding the indices. The trick is we always go in one direction, clockwise or anti-clockwise. It doesn't matter which, as long as we're consistent. So let's say, and in fact I've actually done that here, that going anti-clockwise means a face is going outwards, clockwise means a face is pointing inwards. So let's have a look on this pyramid here. We can see that A, B, C, that's going anti-clockwise, this face is facing out. A, C, D, yep, they're going anti-clockwise, this face is facing out. Now the back face, which is facing away from us, is A, D, E, which is going clockwise. So that's facing away from us. So this way we can differentiate between triangles that are facing out or facing in, which becomes very useful, for example, when we're drawing a triangle, we might want to say, well, don't render the faces that are facing away from us. We want to cull those and not bother having to shade the pixels for those back two faces. Or we might want to say, well, we don't want to draw the faces that are looking towards us because we want to see the inside of an object if we're rendering a cutaway or something like that. So that's how winding works in a nutshell. It doesn't matter whether you go clockwise for forward front faces and anti-clockwise for back faces or the other way around, as long as you're consistent. Because further down the pipeline, when we come to turn these triangles into pixels, it might become important to know whether it's facing away or towards us. We've probably now covered enough to know roughly how geometry is represented inside the computer. We can represent vertices and faces made up of vertices. The next step is to take our description of an object and move it around in 3D space.